Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome to this tutorial. So in this tutorial we are going to cover the Brayton cycle, right? So the Brayton cycle is one of the is used in the gas turbines, and we will solve some tutorial problems of ideal Brayton cycles, and then we will see that an actual Brayton cycle with the compressor efficiency and turbine efficiency, and then later on we will move into the regeneration and reheating concept in Brayton cycles. Okay, so let us begin the first problem of today's tutorial. The first problem is an aircraft engine which operates on a simple ideal Brayton cycle with a pressure ratio of 10. Heat is added to the cycle at a rate of 500 kilowatt. So let us say Q in, if I write, Q in is basically 500 kilowatt, and air passes through the engine at a rate of 1 kg per second. So m dot air is 1 kg per second. Okay, so it is an ideal, simple ideal Brayton cycle, right? And the pressure ratio is given, which is rp is equal to 10. So suppose first step should be the diagram. So here I am going to draw the TS diagram for the Brayton cycle. So x axis is entropy and y axis is temperature. Now it is an ideal Brayton cycle, so the first step is an isentropic compression process from 1 to 2. Second step is constant pressure heat addition, so 2 to 3, and so that is the heat addition Q in. Third step is isentropic expansion in a turbine, and fourth step is 4 to 1, that is the constant pressure heat rejection. Okay, so this is Q out. Okay, so let us now begin. The air is entering in the at the compressor, and the pressure is 70 kilopascal. So P1, that is the inlet of the compressor, it is 70 kilopascal, and T1 is 0 degree centigrade or 273 Kelvin. So that is the inlet condition of the compressor. Determine the power produced by this engine and its thermal efficiency. So we are interested in the power production, the net power output of this engine. So net power output will be the heat that is added, Q in minus Q out. Okay. So, and also its thermal efficiency, right? Later on we will calculate the thermal efficiency. So what we have to use? We have to use constant specific heats at room temperature. Okay. So this is a very simple simple approach. So we are not considering the variable specific heat. In subsequent problem we will see how to deal with variable specific heat. Okay. So for the for step 1 to 2, which is an isentropic compression process, we can write T2 upon T1, okay, that should be equal to P2 upon P1 power of k minus 1 by k. Okay. So first I think we should write the properties. So since we are dealing with constant specific heat at room temperature, we know Cp is 1.005 kilojoule per kg Kelvin, and k is 1.4. This you can get from table 2a, appendix 2a, right. So now if I substitute, so what is P2 by P1? P2 by P1 is nothing but Rp. Okay. So this is Rp to the power of k minus 1 by k. So we can find T2 from this. So T2 will be T1, which is 273 Kelvin, multiplied by 10 to the power of 1.4 minus 1 upon 1.4. So if you calculate, this is 527.1 Kelvin. So after compression, the temperature increases to 527.1 Kelvin. Now we need to find what is T3. For that, what is given is that Q in, that is 500 kilowatt heat is added to this cycle. Now m dot is also given, that is the mass flow rate of air. So we can find that what is the heat addition per unit mass. So heat addition per unit mass, let us say Q in, small q, that is 500 kilowatt upon 1 kg per second. So basically you will get 500 kilojoule per kg. So that is the amount of heat added. Now this should be equal to, that is basically the first law of thermodynamics, if we apply, this Q in should be equal to the amount of heat added between 2 to 3 process, right? And that happens at a constant pressure. So we will take the constant pressure specific heat, and from this we can find T3. So T3 will be T2 plus Q in upon Cp. So T2 is 527.1 plus Q in is, we have estimated at 500 kilojoule per kg upon 1.005. So if you calculate, this comes out to be 1024.6 Kelvin. So that is the temperature after the constant pressure heat addition. Next, we can find out temperature at point number 4, that is after the expansion in the turbine. So for that we will again use this similar type of relationship. Okay, so let us say temperature at the exit T4, that should be equal to T3 multiplied by P4 upon P3 to the power of k minus 1 upon k, right? So that is the relationship. Now you know P4 is basically P1 and P3 is basically P2. So P4 by P3 can be written as P1 upon P2, okay, and this is nothing but 1 over Rp, right? So P2 by P1 is Rp. So P1 by P2 is 1 over Rp. So if I substitute it back here, so T3 is 1024.6, and here you have Rp, which is 10 to the power of k is 1.4. So you have 0.4 upon 1.4 in the power. Okay. So if you evaluate, T4 will come out as 530.7 Kelvin. So that is the temperature after the expansion process. Now what we can find, we need to find what is the amount of work done, right? So there are one way is that we can find what is the Wt, okay, and what is the Wc, okay, and from that we can find out the network output. So Wt is the turbine work output, that should be equal to Cp multiplied by T3 minus T4. Okay. So if I write 1.005, T3 is calculated as 1024.6 and T4 is 530.7 Kelvin. So if you calculate, turbine work output will be 496.4 kilojoule per kg, right? Now we can also calculate the compressor work. So that should be again Cp times T2 minus T1, which is nothing but 1.005. T2 we obtained as 527.1 and T1 is 273 Kelvin. So compressor work you estimate as 255.35 kilojoule per kg. So if I calculate the net work output, W net, so these are all specific work done, so per unit mass. Now we are trying to calculate the net work output per unit of time. So what I am trying to do, I am multiplied it with m dot multiplied by Wt minus Wc. Okay. So this is Wt minus Wc, the unit is kilojoule per kg and m dot is kg per second. So your unit will be kilowatt. Okay. So if I put the numbers, so m dot is 1 kg per second, wt is 496.4 and wc is 255.35. So you calculate it as 241.05 kilowatt. So that is the net work output of the cycle, and the thermal efficiency is nothing but w dot net divided by q dot in, right. So w dot net is 241.05 and q dot in is given in question, that is 500 kilowatt. So the ratio is 0.482 or 48.2%. So that is the thermal efficiency of the cycle. So this was an example of a simple and ideal Breton cycle, and we estimated the net work output of this cycle and also the thermal efficiency. In the next problem, we are going to look into again an ideal gas turbine cycle, but here we have two stages of compression and two stages of expansion, right. So there are two stages of compression and expansion. The pressure ratio across each stage of the compressor and turbine is 3, okay. So let us say RP is 3 across the compressor and turbine. Air enters each stage at of the compressor at 300 Kelvin, okay. So first let us try to draw the diagram and then we will mark all the points in that. So in this problem we have to draw the TS diagram again, and so this is the S axis and this is the temperature axis. Now 1 to 2 is the first stage of compression, which occurs at an isentropic process. 2 to 3 is basically intercooling that happens between two compressors, and you know the T1 and T3 are the same basically, okay. That is what is mentioned here. The air enters each stage of the compressor at 300 Kelvin, okay. So T1 is the inlet of the first compressor and T3 is the inlet of the second compressor, and they are at 300 Kelvin. Now from 3 again you have to compress it to 4, okay. So 3 to 4 is a compression process. Now 4 to 5 will be an isentropic constant pressure heat addition process, okay. 4 to 5 is constant pressure heat addition process. 5 to 6 is expansion in the first stage of turbine. 6 to 7 is again the reheating, and 7 to 8 is expansion in the second stage of turbine, and 8 to 1 is basically the heat rejection step, okay. So it is mentioned that in each of this compressor and turbine the pressure ratio remains the same, that is 3, okay. And the air enters each stage of compressor at 300 Kelvin. So basically T1 and T3 is basically 300 Kelvin, okay. And similarly it is mentioned that air enters turbine at 1200 Kelvin. So T5 is equal to T7 and that is 1200 Kelvin, right. So that is what is given. So T5 equal to T7 is equal to 1200 Kelvin. Okay. So what we have to find? We have to find out the back work ratio, okay, and thermal efficiency of this cycle. So there are two parts of this problem. First part is there is no regenerator. The second part, there is a regenerator with 75% effectiveness, and we have to use variable specific heats in this problem. So to begin with, let us say first we will start with point number 1, that is T1 is equal to 300 Kelvin, and correspondingly we can find what is the relative pressure and the enthalpy, okay. So from table A17 of St. John and Bowles, you can find H1 as 300.19 kilojoule per kg, PR1 is the relative pressure, that is 1.386. Again, from the table you have to find. Now we have to come to point 2. So we will calculate PR2, the relative pressure at point 2, that should be equal to P2 upon P1 multiplied by PR1. Now P2 upon P1 is RP, which is 3, and PR1 is 1.386. So PR2 can be calculated as 4.158, and correspondingly you can find what is H2, that is enthalpy associated with point 2, again from the table A17. Here you have to probably interpolate, because you will find that PR2 values are given for certain temperature, and between two temperatures you have to identify where your PR2 lies, and based on that you have to interpolate. Okay. So after that you will get H2 equal to H4, right, because T2 equal to, I mean the temperature remains the same here, and then you can find enthalpy as 411.26 kilojoule per kg. So that is the state 2 and 4. Now I will go to the state 5, where the temperature at the inlet of the first turbine is 1200 Kelvin, that is given, and correspondingly I can find what is H5, and H5 is equal to H7, right. So from, again from the table A17, I can find enthalpy as 1277.79 kilojoule per kg. And PR5, that is the relative pressure at 5, is 238. So that is what you can obtain. Now we have to find what is point number 6. So PR6 is nothing but P6 upon P5 multiplied by PR5. Now P6 upon P5 is 1 over RP, right. So it is 1 over 3. And PR5 is 238. So this you can calculate as 79.33. Okay, that is PR6. Okay. Now we can again refer to the table and find what is H6, and that H6 should be again equal to H8. Okay. So H6 will be equal to H8, and if you find from the table, again you have to interpolate between two numbers, and then enthalpy can be calculated at 946.36 kilojoule per kg. Okay. So now we have all obtained most of this enthalpies associated with all the points. So I can quickly calculate what is the compressor work, because the back work ratio is basically the ratio of compressor work divided by the turbine work, right. So we will calculate the compressor work, and that can be obtained as, so 1 to 2 is a compression process and 3 to 4 is again a compression process. So I will write it as H2 minus H1 plus H4 minus H3. Now here if you pay attention that H4 is equal to H2 and H3 is equal to H1. So I can write it as 2 times H2 minus H1. Okay. So if I substitute the number, H2 is 411.26 and H1 is 300.19. So this comes out to be 222.14 kilojoule per kg. Okay. So that is the compressor work. Next I will calculate what is the turbine work. Turbine work is basically 2 times H5 minus H6. Okay. So because again if you see there are 2 turbines, one is H between 5 and 6, another is 7 and 8, but H7 is equal to H5 and H8 is equal to H6. So I can write it as 2 times H5 minus H6, and if you write out the number, H5 you obtained as 1277.79 and H6 is 946.36, and then this turbine work output will be 662.86 kilojoule per kg. Now we can calculate the back work ratio, which is nothing but the compressor work that is going into the compressor and the turbine work output. So the compressor work is 222.14 and this is 662.86, and then this comes out to be 33.5%. Okay. So next we have to calculate the thermal efficiency of the cycle. So we can find what is the net work output. Net work output is WT minus WC, which is 662.86 minus 220.14, that is 440.72 kilojoule per kg. And what is the Q in that we can find? So heat is added between two steps, one is 4 to 5, another is 6 to 7, right? If you look at the cycle diagram, so 4 to 5 and 6 to 7. So then you have to add this. So I will write it as H5 minus H4 plus H7 minus H6, and these numbers I will write it as 1277.79 minus H4 is 411.26 plus H7 is again 1277.79 minus H6 is 946.36, and if you calculate, the amount of heat added is 1197.96 kilojoule per kg. So thermal efficiency can be written as net work output divided by Q in. So this comes out to be 440.72 divided by 1197.96, which is 36.8%. Okay. So that is the first part. Now the second part, we are having a regenerator. Okay. So we have to draw some additional points in this diagram. So let us say, okay, I think without doing that also we can do. So whatever heat is at the exit of the turbine is HA, I mean this is the point 8, which is the exit of the second turbine. So in the regeneration, some of the heat that is available in this at this point 8 is used to preheat the gas before it enters the combustor, right? So therefore, so some of the heat from this it will be transferred to this side. Okay. So here let us say 4 to 9 be the point where, which is basically the recuperator, right? 4 to 9 is recuperator, and then 9 to 5 is your combustor. Okay. So 4 to 9, I am writing 4 to 9 is regenerator and 9 to 5 is combustor, and again 6 to 7 is the combustor because that is a reheating part, right. So this 9 to 5 and 6 to 7 will be the heat addition. Okay. And some of the heat that is available between 8 and 1 will be used to preheat the gases after the compressor. Okay. So after preheating, the temperature will be at 9. Okay. So we can find that what is the how much regeneration is done. So here it is said that the regenerator is having 75% effectiveness. Okay. So what does it mean? That here the enthalpy is H8 and here the enthalpy is H4. So the regeneration will be H8 minus H4 multiplied by the effectiveness, right. So if I write it Q regen, that is equal to effectiveness multiplied by H8 minus H4. Now it is 75% effectiveness. H8 we already obtained as 946.36 minus 411.26. So enthalpy after, how much heat is transferred due to the regeneration is basically 401.33 kilojoule per kg. So that is the amount of heat that is coming from the exhaust of the turbine to the to preheat the gases after the compression. Okay, so between 4 to 9, that much, that is the amount of heat is received by this compressed air. Okay, so Q region we already obtained. Now we can find what is the modified amount of work, because now the amount of heat supplied to the combustor will be less. Okay, so earlier, so let us say Q in with regenerator should be Q in original, which we calculated as this, minus Q regen, because that much amount of heat is already taken from the exhaust gases, right. So, I will write it as 1197.96 minus 401.33. So, this will come out as 796.63 kilojoule per kg. Okay. Right. So, what is the thermal efficiency now? Thermal efficiency will be the net work output divided by Q in. So, net work output does not change with regeneration, right, because then if you look at here, what is the net work output? It is between 5 and 6 and 7 and 8. So, work is done by the turbine between 5 and 6 and 7 and 8. So, that does not change with regeneration. Okay, so, that is one of the important point that one has to remember. So, it is W net is unaffected, that is 440.72. But what has reduced is the Q in. So, now the with regenerator the heat supplied will be less. Okay. So, if you calculate the efficiency, you will calculate as 55.3%. Okay. So, with regeneration what is happening, the amount of heat is supplied in less to the combustor compared to without a regenerator, and therefore, the regeneration only improves the thermal efficiency, right. It does not change the specific work or work output of the gas turbine, but it only improves the thermal efficiency. So, now I will move to the next problem. So, next problem is about a simple Breton cycle, and here we will learn the concept of the compressor and turbine isentropic efficiency, right. So far we have seen an ideal cycle where the compression and expansion process in compressor and turbine respectively are isentropic process, but here we will see an actual cycle we will also incorporate the compressor isentropic efficiency and the turbine isentropic efficiency in this problem. So, if you look at this problem, the pressure limits are given. So, the lower pressure is 100 kilopascal and higher pressure is 1600 kilopascal. Okay. So, that is given in this problem. Working fluid is air which enters the compressor at 40 degree centigrade. So, let us say I will draw the TS diagram. So, 1 to 2 will be the compressor, right. So, suppose this is your point 1. So, 1, 2. So, this is, so I am drawing two pressure lines here. So, if I draw a vertical line, so that is basically an isentropic process, and 1 to 2s is an isentropic compression process, right. But here it is an actual cycle, so this will look like this. So, 1 to 2 is the compressor. Okay. Now, 2 to 3 is an is basically the constant pressure heat addition, and here it does not say that there is any loss in the combustor, loss of pressure in the combustor, but in some cases it can say that there is some 5% pressure loss in the combustor. Then you can draw, then your point 3 will not lie on this constant pressure line, but then it will be at a lower point. Okay. So, now 2 to 3 is basically your constant pressure heat addition process. Now, 3 to 4s is an isentropic expansion process, and if you draw it like this, then this is the actual process 3 to 4. Okay. So, 1 2 3 to 4 is the actual. And 1 to 2s, 3 to 4s is an ideal Bredon cycle. Okay, so now here the concept of compressor isentropic efficiency and the turbine isentropic efficiency will come. So what is given is the compressor isentropic efficiency is 0.85 and turbine isentropic efficiency is 0.88. Temperature of air at the inlet of the compressor is 40 degree centigrade. So, T1 is 40 degree centigrade or 313 Kelvin, and air flows at a rate. So, volumetric flow rate of air is given 850 meter cube per minute. Okay. So, what is given? P1 is equal to P4, that is equal to 100 kilopascal, and P2 is equal to P3, that is equal to 1600 kilopascal. But please consider, I mean, in another modification of this, it could be like that there will be some deviation from this if there is a pressure loss in the combustor, then this will be the actual process 2 to 3. Okay, and then there will be an isentropic expansion here, and it will come to a slightly higher pressure. Okay, but these things we are not considering in this problem, so I will remove these lines actually. Okay, so now to begin with, here we have to use the variable specific heat, right? The air standard assumptions are applicable. Air is an ideal gas with variable specific heats. That is the assumption that we are going to make. Now, if you write down the property, so we'll be using R as 0.287 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Okay. So let us start from the process 1 to 2, which is the compression process. It is not an isentropic process, but T1 is given, which is 313 Kelvin. And correspondingly, you can find the enthalpy, and enthalpy comes out to be 313.6 kilojoule per kg, again from the table you can find. Now, you can also find basically pressure is also needed. Pascal. So, here temperature is 313 Kelvin, and correspondingly you can find S1, which is 5.749 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Okay. So, this is the state 1. So, now I will move to the state 2, where the pressure is 1600 kilopascal, and if you say that S is equal to S1, then what will happen? S2S is 5.749. Okay, so this is for the isentropic process, and correspondingly you can find H2S, which is 691.9 kilojoule per kg. Okay, so we are assuming that 1 to 2S is an isentropic process, and therefore I am equating S2S, that entropy at this 0.2s is equal to the entropy at 0.1, and now I know pressure and entropy, and then I can find what is the H2S. Okay. So, this H2S will come out as 691.9 kilojoule per kg. Now, compressor efficiency is given, that can be written as H2S minus H1, that is the isentropic work done, H2S minus H1. Divided by the actual work done, that is H2 minus H1. Okay. So, this will help us to calculate H2. Okay. So, H2 you can find it from this, but H2 minus H1 is 313.6, that should be equal to H2S minus H1, that is 691.9 minus 313.6 divided by the compressor efficiency, which is 85%. So, from this you can find H2 as 758.6 kilojoule per kg. So, that is the enthalpy after the compression step. Next, I will move to the expansion process. So, there T4 is given 650 degree centigrade, that is given in the problem, right. The exhaust temperature is T4 650 degree centigrade, and correspondingly you can find H4 as 959.2 kilojoule per kg. Now, we know that turbine efficiency is 88%, and that should be equal to H3 minus H4 divided by H3 minus H4S. Okay. So, if you look at H3 minus H4 is the actual work by the turbine, and H3 minus H4S is the isentropic work done. So, actual work done is less than the isentropic work done. So, we have to take a ratio like this. So, this is the actual work done, and this is the ideal isentropic work done. Okay. So, now if I substitute H3 and H4, so basically H3, we cannot find the enthalpy at state 3 directly, but here you can use that EES program, and from that you can find H3 as 1790 kilojoule per kg. Okay. And correspondingly you can find temperature T3 can be found as 1353 degree centigrade, and S3 is 6.75 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Okay. So, now we can proceed with this, but this can be obtained using a trial and error approach. Okay. This solution can be obtained as a trial and error approach. So, you have to guess some value of H3, and then you can find the error, and then you can improve your guess, and then finally this will be your solution. Now, otherwise you can use the EES software, and then you can obtain this solution. Next is that the mass flow rate we have to find. So, what is given is that mass flow rate at the compressor is 850 meter cube per minute. So, at the step 1, this compressor, the volume flow rate is given. So, volume flow rate is 850 meter cube per minute. Okay. So, I have to multiply it with the density at point 1. So, let us say rho 1. Okay. So, 850 meter cube per minute. So, I am converting into meter cube per second, and now rho 1 is the density which can be obtained from the equation of state. So, it is P by RT1. So, pressure is 100 kilopascal, and R is 0.287, and temperature at the compressor inlet is 40 degree centigrade or 313 Kelvin. So, this gives you the mass flow rate of 1577 kg per second. Okay. Now, we can calculate the net power output of the net power output. First, we have to calculate what is the compressor work. Compressor work will be m dot H2 minus H1. So, m dot is 15.77, H2 is 758.6 kilojoule per kg, and H1 is 313.6 kilojoule per kg. So, W dot C will be 7017 kilowatt. Now, we can calculate what is the turbine output. That should be equal to m dot H3 minus H4. So H3, so m dot is 1577, H3 is 1790 and H4 is 959.2. Then this will give you the W dot turbine, that is 13098 kilowatt. So the network output will be the turbine work minus the compressor work. So this is 6081 kilowatt. Now the back work ratio, that is the second part of the question, that should be equal to W dot C divided by W dot T, and if you substitute the number, it will be 0.536. Third part is the thermal efficiency. So for thermal efficiency, we need to find what is the Q dot in. So Q dot in is basically m dot H3 minus H2. So m dot is 15.77 kg per second, H3 is 1790 and H2 is 758.6 kilojoule per kg. This will give you 16,262 kilowatt, and the thermal efficiency will be the ratio of network output by the amount of heat supplied. So network output is 6081 divided by 16262, so that is 37.4%. Okay, so that is the solution. So here we have considered an actual Brayton cycle, and what is given in the question is the turbine and the compressor isentropic efficiencies, and from that we obtained the net power output of the cycle and the back work ratio and the thermal efficiency. Now we will quickly move into the move to the next problem. So next problem is a gas turbine plant which operates on simple Brayton cycle between two pressure limits, that is 100 and 700 kilopascal. So here the air is entering the compressor at 30 degree centigrade at a rate of 12.6 kg per second. So m dot is given 12.6 kg per second. So the lowest pressure is 100 kilopascal and the highest pressure is 700 kilopascal. It is a simple Brayton cycle. Diesel is used as a fuel, and the calorific value of the diesel is given. So heating value is given 42 megajoule per kg, okay, or you can write 42,000 kilojoule per kg. In the combustor, an air fuel ratio of 60 is used. That means this is the mass of air divided by the mass of fuel. Okay. So this is the air that enters, m dot air is 12.6 kg per second at the compressor. So the combustion efficiency is given. So eta combustion is 97%. Combustion gases leave the combustor and enter the turbine, whose isentropic efficiency is 85%. Okay. Treating the combustion gases as air and using constant specific heats at 500 degree centigrade, determine the isentropic efficiency of the compressor. Okay. So isentropic efficiency of the turbine is given 85%. So we have to find out the compressor isentropic efficiency and the net power output, W net, and the back work ratio, thermal efficiency, and the second law efficiency. Okay. So it is a fairly big problem. Okay, so to begin with, again I will draw the TS diagram. So 1 to 2. So first I will draw the two constant pressure lines. So 1 to 2 is the compression process, 2 to 3 is constant pressure heat addition. So I think the problem, there is no pressure drop that is given in the combustor, so I will assume it as 2 to 3, and 3 to 4 is your expansion process in the turbine. Okay, so we have to deal with air standard assumptions, and we'll again neglect the changes in kinetic and potential energy are negligible across each component. And air is an ideal gas with constant specific heat that is given, right? So we have to take the constant specific heat at 500 degree centigrade. So now, if you look at the property table, that is table A to B, okay, of Senjel and Bolz. At 500 degree centigrade, okay, you can find Cp as 1.093 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Cv, you can find is as 0.806 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. R is 0.287 kilojoule per kg Kelvin, and K is the ratio of Cp Cv. That is 1.357. Okay, so these are the properties that we have to use. Now, to begin the solution, first we will look into the isentropic process. So 1 to 2s is then isentropic compression process. So suppose if the process is isentropic, then we can calculate what is the temperature after the isentropic compression process. So T2s can be obtained as T1 multiplied by P2 upon P1 to the power of k minus 1 up by k. So, T1 is given, T1 is 30 degree centigrade or 303 Kelvin, and P2 by P1 is the ratio, which is 7, right, 700 by 100. So, 7 to the power of k minus 1 is 0.357 divided by 1.357. So, you can calculate T2s as 505.6 Kelvin. Now, we can calculate what is the actual temperature T2, right, because we know compressor efficiency. So actual temperature is given, right, in the problem the actual temperature at the exit of the compressor is given, that is 260 degrees. Right. So, T2 is given 260 degree or it is 533 Kelvin. So, now we can calculate the compressor efficiency. So, compressor efficiency is the isentropic work done divided by the actual work done. So, if I take the constant specific heat, then instead of enthalpy, I can write it in terms of the temperature. So, it will be written as T2s minus T1, that is the actual work done by the actual work done in the compressor divided by the this is the isentropic work done, T2s minus T1 divided by T2 minus T1 is the actual work done. So, now if I substitute the numbers, it is 505.6, T1 is 303 Kelvin, T2 is 533 and T1 is 303. So, compressor efficiency you will find it as 88.1%. Okay. So, that is the first part of the problem. In the second part, we have to calculate the net power output and the back work ratio and the thermal efficiency. Okay. So, for that let us say we can calculate what is the m dot fuel, right. So, m dot fuel can be obtained from the air fuel ratio, which is given, right. So, air fuel ratio is basically the ratio of mass of air that is working in this cycle divided by the mass of the fuel. Okay. So, mass of fuel can be found from this expression. So, m dot air is given, m dot air is 12.6 kg per second, that is given in the problem statement, and now I will divide it by the air fuel ratio and this will give us 0.21 kg per second. So, that is the mass of fuel that is added in the combustor. Okay. So, the calorific value of the fuel, that is diesel, is given. So, we can find what is the amount of heat that is added in the combustor. Okay. So, that can be written as m dot f multiplied by q hv, the heating value, and then the eta combustion efficiency of the combustion. So, amount of fuel burned is 0.21 kg per second. And 42,000 kilojoule per kg is the heating value and the combustion efficiency is 0.97. So then we can calculate the amount of heat supplied, that is 8555.4 kilojoule or kilowatt basically, right. So this is the amount of heat that is added in the combustor. Now from the first law of thermodynamics, we can calculate, we can write Q dot in as m dot. Now here basically this is the sum of the fuel and the air mass flow rate, and Cp is the constant pressure specific heat, and T3 minus T2. Okay. So T3 minus T2 is the temperature difference across the combustor. Okay. So if I substitute the values here, so I know what is T2. So we know m dot f and m dot a, and we already calculated Q dot in as this value. So we can calculate T3, that is the exit temperature of the combustor. So I am skipping this, you can calculate this while solving this problem at home. So T3 is 1144 Kelvin. Okay. So that is the temperature after the combustor. Now we can find what is T4S, that is the temperature at the exit of the turbine when the process is isentropic. Okay. So 3 to 4S is an isentropic expansion and 3 to 4 is an actual expansion, right? This is actual and this one is isentropic. Okay. So we can find what is T4S. T4S can be written as T3 multiplied by P4 by P3 to the power of K minus 1 by K. So T3 is 1144 Kelvin and P4 is 100 kilopascal and P3 is 700 kilopascal, and this is 0.357 divided by 1.357 K minus 1 by K, right. So then you can calculate T4 is as 685.7 Kelvin. Now we know what is the turbine efficiency, and from that we can find out the actual temperature at the exit of the turbine. So this can be written as T3 minus T4 divided by T3 minus T4S. So in the numerator this is the actual work done by the turbine, in the denominator this is the isentropic work done. Okay. So we need to find T4. So we know T3, right, T3 is 1144 Kelvin, we know T4S, we know turbine efficiency, that is given 85%, right. So from that I can calculate what is T4, and T4 comes out to be 754.4 Kelvin, right. Now I can calculate all the other things like the compressor work done. So compressor work done will be m dot air multiplied by Cp T2 minus T1. So you substitute the number, m dot air is 12.6 kg per second, Cp is 1.093 and T2 minus T1 is 533 minus 303 Kelvin. So this will give you 3167.5 kilowatt. Now what is the turbine work output? Turbine work, here you have to consider both m dot A and m dot fuel. Okay. Cp is the same and it is T3 minus T4, right. So here m dot A plus m dot F you have to do. So m dot that you please carefully do. So m dot A is 12.6 and m dot fuel is 0.21, Cp is 1.093, T3 is 1144 Kelvin and T4 is the is this one, 754.4 Kelvin. So from that you can find what is the turbine work output, and that is 5455 kilowatt. Now we can calculate the net work output of the system, that is W dot T minus W dot C, and if you put the numbers you will get it as 2287.5 kilowatt. You can calculate the back work ratio, which is the ratio of W dot C divided by W dot T, and if you substitute the numbers then you will get it as 58.07%. Now the thermal efficiency can be calculated, we know W dot net and we have to divide by the heat that is supplied. So network output of the system is 2287.5, Q dot in is 8555.4, and then the thermal efficiency will be 0.267. Okay. So we have to calculate in the last part, that is the second law efficiency. Okay, for second law efficiency of the cycle is defined as the ratio of actual thermal efficiency to the maximum possible thermal efficiency, that is the Carnot efficiency, right. So this is the expression, the second law efficiency is the thermal efficiency of the cycle divided by the maximum efficiency of a Carnot cycle, right. So if I write eta max of a Carnot cycle, which can be written as 1 minus the lowest temperature, right, divided by the highest temperature. Now what is the lowest temperature of the cycle? That is 303 Kelvin. And what is the highest temperature of the cycle? That is 1144 Kelvin. That is the at the exit of the combustor. This is at the inlet of the compressor and this is at the exit of the combustor, okay, TL and TH. So from that you can calculate the maximum efficiency that is possible of a Carnot cycle, and it is 0.735. Now the second law efficiency will be the actual thermal efficiency of the cycle, which we just now calculated as 0.267, okay, and we have to divide it by the maximum efficiency 0.735. So this will give us as 0.364. Okay, so that is the second law efficiency, or 36.4%. Okay, so that brings us to the end of this problem. So in this problem, we have looked into an actual Brayton cycle, which is a simple Brayton cycle operating between 100 and 700 kilopascal, and based on the calorific value of the fuel, we estimated the amount of heat supplied, and from that we obtained several things such as the net power output, back work ratio, thermal efficiency, and towards the end we calculated the second law efficiency. So this brings us to the end of this tutorial, and we will continue further in the next class. Thank you.